Scenery, lush vegetation, and magnificent gardens, home to 4 million Kashmiri people. A verdant and mountainous land, enchanting visitors and evoking poetic writings from ancient times. The capital city, Srinagar, is nestled 5,200 feet in the western Himalayas. However, the soaring Himalayan mountains which surround its heartland, like the ramparts of a natural fortress, have failed to protect Kashmir from the incursions of a long sequence of conquerors. What at first sight appears to be a haven of enchantment and artistic creativity must also be seen in the context of its turbulent history and violent struggles which have often brought bloodshed and suffering. The Kashmiris, caught in the crossfire. Sounds of gunfire echo back and forth in the hills. Fighting continues between the Jammu Kashmir Liberation Movement and the regulars of the Indian Army garrisoned in this usually quiet valley. A Kashmiri farmer listens to see if the fighting is close today. Will his family need to go for shelter again? Just last week, his handicraft business was burnt down, and his son's family was dragged out of their home while the military searched for separatists. Now, the whole family must work together to support themselves off the land. Since 1947, Jammu and Kashmir have been a battleground, an area claimed by both India and Pakistan. The Pakistani-controlled part of old Kashmir is known as Azad, or Free Kashmir. The line of control, or ceasefire line, which was defined by the United Nations, is the de facto or temporary border between the two countries, with a United Nations peacekeeping force still stationed in the area. Today, the Indian part of the area is called Jammu and Kashmir, and is made up of three districts, with the area of Kashmir being in constant dispute. Even though Jammu and Kashmir is the only Indian state with a separate constitution, conflicts between Hindu law and Muslim law are frequent. The Kashmiri people continue to see their culture threatened by the Hindu majority and are resistant to change. The Indian Army maintains a strong and aggressive presence in the Kashmir Valley. Almost weekly, tragic news reports describe death of Indian soldiers and separatist-minded Kashmir insurgents and civilians. Not only have the Kashmiris been frustrated in their struggle for independence, but they face severe social hurdles as well. They have the lowest female literacy rate in India. Only 16% of the women can read or write, compared to 36% of the adult men. In this land, overladen with natural colors and rich with nature's gifts, stark poverty also reigns. Once a thriving business and tourism center, now army bunkers, curfews, and outbreaks remind valley inhabitants of the constant military presence. Living in one of the most remote areas of Asia, Kashmiris eke out a living mainly off the land. Even in the midst of uncertainty and fear, Kashmiris' attachment to their land, to its beauty, and its fertility remains passionate. From a hilltop perch, one can obtain a splendid view of the valley, filled with houseboats and village houses. Picturesque Kashmir chalets and snow-capped mountains adorn the area known as the Switzerland of the East. The Jhelum River is the valley's main source of sustenance and is a reservoir of songs, poems, and legends. In the shadow of towering mountains, shikaras, like slim decorated gondolas, skim peacefully along the waters from early dawn to setting sun. Visitors as well as residents travel to and from their houseboats on canopied shikaras propelled by heart-shaped oars. Floating past houseboats moored along the riverfront provides one of the best opportunities to observe the life of the people of Kashmir. One sees people washing their clothes, cleaning their boats, or enjoying family times together. Vendors set out to entice visitors with film or other assorted goods, from fruits and flowers to handicrafts. The sale of agricultural products, cottage crafts such as carpets, furniture, and papier-mâché, provide income for the people and government. Kashmiri papier-mâché, with its jewel-like colors, is valued all over India and the world. Skilled craftsmen with pliant fingers weave millions of intricate stitches on silk or linen cloths. Kashmir carpet weaving has also attained perfection and world recognition. In the summer months, tourists flock to houseboats and villas to partake of the cool mountain airs and refreshing beauty of the vale. In cold winter months, the valley is generally isolated from visitors. Groups of villagers huddle around fires or warm kettles, or travel bundled in woolen shawls throughout the misty city streets or water canals. Joining together around fires and sharing folk tales, jokes, or ballads, or partaking of an authentic Kashmiri meal are favorite activities. Kashmiri cooking is based on the culinary art of the Mughals and Persians, with a cuisine rich in saffron and delicate spices. For centuries, Kashmir has served as the crossroads for caravans of merchants from Central Asia, Mughal emperors, and mystics from the Muslim world, all of whom have left their imprint on Kashmir. In the 16th century, Mughal invaders conquered the Vale of Kashmir, bringing to an end centuries of Buddhist and Hindu rule. By the end of this five-century rule, most of the population had been converted to Islam. Today, 95% of population is Sunni Muslim. At appointed times during the day, the call to prayer can be heard drifting through the village and across the waters. As night falls, the crescent and star symbol beckon the faithful to the local mosque. Many Muslims also gather at shrines, graves, and holy sites to pray and seek blessing. Who could tell them about the blessings they could receive through relationship with Christ? Christian missionaries from outside the country first went to the Vale of Kashmir in the 1850s. The last known foreign missionaries left in 1987, and now there are no known full-time missionaries serving in Kashmir. Even through the fires of persecution and adversity, one Catholic church and one Protestant church currently minister in Srinagar. Primarily, non-Kashmiris attend these churches, and only a few other small congregations of Kashmiri believers are thought to exist in the entire area. There are only a very few Christian nationals and occasional short-term missionaries ministering to the millions of Kashmiris. It is estimated that there are only 400 Christians, 0.01% of the 4 million Kashmiris.
I have been traveling Kashmir Valley and I found that the people of Kashmir are totally neglected. Why should this particular group be left out?
Me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living
about it, and God has given us this burden that we as a family should do something, and we have devoted our lives and we have now this opportunity to reach out to this special Kashmiri group.
Present mission efforts are forging cultural and linguistic bridges to reach the Kashmiris from outside this isolated land. Kashmiris are generally resistant to the gospel, but many are open for the first time due to a continuous, unsettled lifestyle of civil strife in Kashmir.
Through His love, our hearts can feel all the grief they bear. They must hear the words of life. Only we can.
Be the time for the Kashmiri people to receive the gospel. I believe this is because many, many people have also been impressed with the need to pray, and these prayers are being answered. When we go and speak to Kashmiris, they are receiving the truth. We see a response. Some are beginning to believe the truth and beginning to make a commitment, even to the point of having to stand up against persecution. Through business contacts and the beginning of an import-export business, this opened doors for relationship to be developed, and through that relationship, the gospel was able to be proclaimed.
There are many opportunities for Christian workers to be involved in ministry to the Kashmiri people. Medical teams to continue on with previously successful inroads. Students and people of all ages to join in trekking trips, which will be involved in prayer and witnessing throughout the Kashmir region. Long-term workers first engaging in language and cultural study of Kashmiris. Support through prayer and financial giving towards ongoing projects. Continued production of media resources and Bible translation work specifically designed for the Kashmiri peoples. Because the majority of Kashmiris are illiterate, they must be able to hear and see the gospel message. The Kashmiris, caught in the crossfire of political and spiritual strife, are needing to hear of the Prince of Peace and the only one who will bring spiritual strength and stability to their uncertain future. Recent uprisings have kept the people in a constant state of unrest.
As a Kashmiri, I speak on behalf of all other people of our homeland and ask for the peace in our country. Not a temporary peace, but a peace which reigns forever and ever in our homeland. And a peace which gives us peace in our heart, minds, and over all our valley.
We who know the peace of Christ have the hope that Kashmiris can be made free by the truth.
God loves these people, and your prayers will release God's mighty power to change hardened hearts of Kashmiri people.
Fervent prayer support and participation in ongoing Christian ministry will bring the good news of the gospel message to them. Pray for lasting peace and a peaceful solution to the continued violence in Jammu and Kashmir. Pray for nationals and other evangelists who are sharing the gospel message with the Kashmiri people. Pray for medical and educational work among the Kashmiris that will meet real needs and open people's eyes to see the love of Jesus in action. Pray that available scriptures will be used effectively and that the entire Bible will soon be available in a modern Kashmiri language version. Pray for the Kashmiri language radio broadcast and for the distribution of contextualized audio-visual presentations of the gospel message. Pray for the birth of a vibrant, culturally relevant church among the Kashmiris of India and Pakistan. Pray that the Lord may open doors for future long-term workers and provision for ongoing ministries in Kashmir. There is a paradise on earth, this must be it, declared the great Mughal conqueror, who had just moved across Afghanistan, subduing all before him. He was gazing over what many people believe to be the most beautiful valley in Asia. Today, Kashmir is charmingly beautiful, but spiritually, it is a dry and parched desert. In Ezekiel chapter 37, God commanded Ezekiel, looking at the valley of dry bones, to have faith and prophesy life into them. Our faithful prayers for the Kashmiri people can also bring spiritual new life, break spiritual strongholds, and release the Kashmiris into God's true kingdom paradise. And I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, says the Lord.